Now, what does something like that, what does the fluctuation in funding have in terms of an emotional impact on the people working on the game? Like, how much does that affect you guys?
A lot of my job is to shield everyone and protect everyone. The employee rights in Denmark are really good because you're always entitled to, even though the company, if you get fired or if you go bankrupt, everybody is entitled to 3 months of salary, so you're kind of protected every time to find a new job. And also, we chose the employees, but they needed to know. Again, when we were sure that the money coming, and we just had to know for two months. You know, we said to them how the things were. I think the most kind of emotional questions were me and my partner, because we were always discussing this about how to go about it. You know, even though you're really safe, sure that the product is good, you know, you always get uncertain sometimes, you know, when it's bad times. So, yeah.
Now, I don't know how aware you are in Canada's funding, but over here we have different levels of government that developers can apply for, different grants and so forth. What is it like in Denmark? How did you go about getting those grants? Is there a whole part to grant proposal writing over there?
It's kind of bad in Denmark. There was one grant, the first one, and hasn't been one since, which we got some money from, and now they have everything. And they've taken one year and they're finding out if this was a good scheme or not. They have a Nordic one, which we also got money from, which covers all the Nordic countries, which is Denmark, Sweden, Norway, maybe Finland or something. And that's a really simple process, actually. Takes some time. The Danish one was really, a lot of bureaucracy, a lot of tape, which also hurt. We have a big problem with some of the schemes.
So it's not a difficult process at all then to get it?
No, the problem is there's not a consistent scheme which you can count on. You know, you can set up a company and say...
Oh no, I'm just...
Laughing at
I find that humorous. A consistent scheme like that, I'm sure that there are people here in Canada who are just really good at writing grant proposals and probably...
And also feel that it's a consistent... When you set up a business, you know that this is something you can promise your investor, promise yourself. You can adjust your salaries, and you can, create a business plan from the beginning. And then when you have to start the company, now there's nothing. So you start the company knowing that maybe there will be something, maybe there will not. When it will be, then there's a lot of companies applying. And only, I think it's for a year who gets this, so it's really few. So, yeah, but I can say that everybody in Denmark is looking at Canada for how you're doing here. You're becoming really popular, and we send government people over here to take tours and to learn how you're doing it and is it successful, maybe also not to do it, maybe it's something you can do better, but like learning from someone who's really trying to invest in startups and invest in games.
Well, that fills me with a little bit of national pride when you guys are looking to Canada for examples. I had nothing to do with that, but as Canada's ambassador here on stage, we'll take that as a compliment for all of us. So what other kinds of funding do the game have? We know that there was some venture capital, there was government grants, anything else?
Oh, that was it.
Did no parents involved?
There is parents involved, but not in the money.
What juice did they bring you lunch? I guess that helps.
No, I always been good with the economy, so I had a lot of a big stash. And he has a big loan, and he didn't mind like expanding that loan. So
yeah, everyone has multiple mortgages here. So
yeah, exactly. Actually, also loan for something in my house. So it was good. And again, I think as an entrepreneur, you really want to invest a lot of time yourself. You really want to invest a lot of money because the further you can take your projects, the less you need. The further down the line you need to. VCs of the money. You won't really want to expect coming, having no money in it and having someone else to pay for your project. It's really, it's an uncle if you're lucky, to give you money to help you learn. It's not an investor or anyone else. You really want to invest in this and you really want to get this far. You really want to make the prototype, hopefully, maybe the vertical slice if you can afford it, have the market approved if you can, have all the analytics done. So you're the expert, you know, you have to go to the trade show, you have to know what's out there, find the competitors. You really want to be the expert at this before you got out and sell it. And that's what we did, of course.
Now, in terms of selling the game, it's out on Xbox Live Arcade. Are you guys exploring any sort of other digital distribution means for it?
It's exclusive, so I'm good.
You're not going to call it like Limbo 2 and just add like a little section at the end there?
No.
So what is next for Limbo then? Are you allowed to license the character? Are we going to see little silhouette boy action figures or anything like that?
We have a lot of ideas. Right now, as I opened it up before, we have kind of a disagreement with investors. So we don't know where to take it next, and maybe we'll just leave it as where it is. But we have a lot of ideas where to expand on, you know, the brand of the game.
So where do the investors come in now and starting disagreements with you? Like, what are these disagreements about?
It's the future of the company, because we, in reality, the founders and investors have two different agendas. You know, we want to make a good game and make money, and they want to make money and just don't care about, you know, you or the game. So it's without opening the lid.
Well, we only have 10 minutes left, so. So yeah, you're really not opening the lid like Johnny a little bit.
No, it's not.
That's not.
It could be good fun to talk about, you know, people here who want to invest in the board, because all publishers, to really think about the consequences of the being there and really doing background searches and ask a lot about the exit and really take it seriously, because we took it seriously actually. And we had a plan about exits, which was in about 3 or 4 years. And we thought about it, but we also thought that it's like 3 or 4 years in the future. So we'll have enough time to find a good partner and create an exit, which is good for everyone. And one of the disagreements is also we went to exit, you know, when the investors want to do it early, which is now, and we don't want to, because we're not really ready to, we'll never be ready to leave it, actually. But we would like, you know, we wouldn't mind having a partner which had expertise or, you know, would allow us to hire more talent. Because right now we started a new project and we need talent, and it's, you know, it would be great just to scale up, you know, really easily with a partner.
Now, honestly, I imagine that the success of Limbo has brought you more attention from potential investors. What are you actually looking in as a company in an investor?
For someone who understands it's the value of games is in the long run. If you see what Valve built up over a couple of years, you know, they also obviously have Steam, but you know, they build up brands. I'll definitely, you know, instantly buy whatever they make, because they take time. A lot of companies, I won't mention names, but they built the games, huge relay games within 1 year. You can feel it, you know, that I don't think they're good games, you know, they're missing soul, they're just like kind of business model. And you can feel, you know, the big difference between the business model thought when you tap into a market where they just try to expand on graphics and, you know, known things, compared to people who really want to move the markets.